Do you have any, like, weirdly specific phobias?
I don't think so. Why? What's yours?
Games on February 22nd against goalies named Dave.
Let's go!
Why not?
The Toronto Maple Leafs!
I guess my brand is a yell and scream. I don't script these.
Are the Leafs all right?
So what you get is from the heart. Welcome to LFR. Leafs lose 3-0 at the hands of the Calgary Flames, but I think we're going to be doing a little bit more talking about the Leafs situation than the game in this one. And we should have known that something ominous was coming, because Jake Muzzin took a high stick at the end of the last game, and we still hadn't heard an update, which is weird. Like, how long does it take to get stitches?
It wasn't stitches.
Muzzin suffered a broken bone in his face from a follow-through shot from Tyler Toffoli. Zach Hyman is day-to-day. He blocked that ugly shot. Joe Thornton is day-to-day. We don't know what's going on there. And at the last minute, we find out Frederik Andersen is actually battling something, or rather not find out, we were just told, again, I'm starting to get concerned! So the starter is Michael Hutchinson, and the backup is Joseph Woll. Leading to these lines, and I hate to make you relive that nightmare, but here they are once again. John Tavares, Austin Matthews, and Mitch Marner on the top line. Loaded up. The last time we saw this was Game 5 against Columbus. Does anyone remember how that went? Or the score, for that matter! Second line, Alexander Barabanov, yeah, that makes sense, Alexander Kerfoot, and William Nylander. Jimmy Vesey, Pierre Engvall, Ilya Mikheyev, don't actually mind that, and Nick Petan, Travis Boyd, and Jason Spezza. On defense, Riley Brody, that makes sense. Dermot Hall, that makes sense. Big game for Dermot. And Mikko Lettinen with Zach Bogosian. And I already told you about the goalies.
What?
It's easy to say in retrospect because the Leafs lost, but I don't dig those lines. Barabanov with Kerfoot and Nylander, I don't know how I'm supposed to interpret that as anything but an enormous opportunity for Barabanov where he either shows the Leafs or doesn't that he belongs on this team and it could lead to a trade. Steve, that sounds kind of dramatic. Yeah, so does putting like your 15th forward on the second line. I also don't really understand putting Tavares with Matthews and Marner. Gosh, it looks fun, but when you have depth issues because of all the injuries, why would you then load up a line? Because that forces you to, oh, I don't know, put Barabanov in the second line! And while I think that's an easy thing to criticize, an easy thing to rant about, I don't think that's why the Leafs lost this game. I'm actually going to be able to talk about this game pretty quickly. Because there were 3 goals, all by the Flames, 1 in each period. Let's talk about them specifically, right? What happened here? What went wrong? And we'll also talk about David Ayers a little bit later, too. Less than 4 minutes in, Rasmus Andersen was just kind of a lazy shot from barely the point. It squeaks through Hutchinson, and Sam Bennett is able to pounce on the loose puck. It's a goal. It's a 1-0 deficit. And I'm looking at it and going, oof, Hutchinson! And Ray Ferraro on the broadcast goes, Hutchinson's gotta have that. This isn't a criticism of Ferraro. I really like the job he does, but it was difficult to tell with the naked eye upon first watching it. That puck was deflected by John Tavares getting his stick in there. Why? That shot from Andersen was not dangerous. Hutchinson, in all likelihood, was probably going to stop it with his pad and direct it wide. But instead, that little change in direction causes it to go through his 5-hole and Bennett gets the loose puck. That's not Hutchinson's fault. I know we get into the trap of, oh, it'd be nice to get a save. What, a save on your own players? Second period, Mark Giordano on the power play takes a shot and Matthew Tkachuk tips it in perfectly. You could talk about the absence of Jake Muzzin all you want. You can talk about Hutchinson, but it's Mark Giordano and Matthew Tkachuk doing what they do best. Third period, Flames power play again. Of all the shots I wish Hutchinson would have stopped, it'd be this one. He actually stops a flurry. The Leafs aren't able to clear it. And then Monahan just chips it kind of perfectly. And it's this little floater that ends up beating them. It's 3-0. It's done. And man, did the Flames need this. You see Tkachuk, big Selly. You see Monahan, big Selly. This team is in such a rut. And here's the thing that frustrates me as a Leafs fan, losing that game. The Flames weren't even good. They weren't even good. I don't care how many people were injured. That's a winnable game. I know you're not going to win them all, but that's a winnable game. And here's why I said those weird lines that Sheldon Keefe decided to go with weren't that big of a factor in this game. Barely any of the game was played at 5-on-5. Because the story of the game is there were 12 power plays. 12! Out of those 12 power plays, the Leafs had 7 of them, including a 5-on-3 that was over 90 seconds, and they couldn't get one past Dave Rittich. Now, Rittich made a few huge saves in this one. Morgan Riley hits the crossbar, John Tavares absolutely robbed, Jason Spezza absolutely robbed. There were some really good chances in this one. Willie had a really good one on the power play. Matthews, always a threat, he was in there, couldn't get one through. I think I remember Engvall having a really good chance. Did the Leafs have the better goaltender? No, but I don't think Michael Hutchinson cost them the game. You might have noticed the Leafs didn't score! And they had 7 power play opportunities to do it. It's hard to rant about it too much because they have the best power play in the NHL so far this season. The best. But they had the second best one in this game, and that's why they lost. 7 opportunities wasted. The Leafs had 7 shots on those power plays. That's 1 per power play. That's not good enough. Meanwhile, on the 5 power play opportunities that the Flames had, they had 12, and 2 of them snuck by Hutch. And the reason I said Calgary wasn't even that good, because obviously their penalty kill was good, and their power play, but at even strength, those lines that the Leafs had, that ragtag bunch of I don't even know what they're trying, they somehow managed to draw 7 power plays. We can criticize loading up the top line. I don't know if I'm the biggest fan of it, but they drew 3 penalties at 5-on-5, and Mitch Marner went down for the 5-on-3. Nordstrom tripped Marner, and Tavares got held in the first. Marner drew the 5-on-3 opportunity in the second, and Giordano tripped Matthews in the third. That line actually wasn't that bad. Nylander needed to be better, and he drew 1. Dermott drew 1. Boyd drew 1. I know this is the anniversary of my face going from pale to purple talking about the Toronto Maple Leafs losing an actual National Hockey League game to a 42-year-old damn pony driver who works for them! Have my lungs shrunk since that? Oh my god, I'm gonna pass out. I'm literally seeing stars. How did I make that video? But I'm sure what no one wants to hear after a 3-0 shutout loss is the Leafs, all things considered, we're good. I mean, the difference of this roster from the one that won the previous game. You're down 2 forwards, 2 additional forwards to the ones who were already injured. You're down Jake Muzzin, and not only are you down your starter, but your backup's not in there too. So you're on your 3rd goalie, would be your 4th if the Devils hadn't claimed Aaron Dell. But it's okay. They've gotten lots of use out of him. He's played 1 AHL and 1 NHL game. I will die mad about it! But it's okay. Waivers is doing its job because it's meant to get guys playing in the NHL. What's that? Aaron Dell would have played more games with the Leafs already. Whoops! I'm sorry, I'll die mad that that team claimed 2 goalies and then barely used either of them! Now naturally you're mad, I'm mad. I don't like when the Leafs lose, and I do not like when they get shut out. But they play that game 100 times, they probably win more than 50 of them. The way that they played, they drew more calls, they were the more dangerous team, I thought. They were just better. Nah, power play didn't look very good, didn't look very dangerous, struggled to gain the zone sometimes. It's weird. Considering that was the Leafs' top unit last year, and it was dangerous, boy did William Nylander look confused. Not even confused. I know a lot of people like to call him lazy, and there are certainly instances in his game where I'm like, ah, you could have tried harder there. In this one, I felt bad for him, because I'm like, okay, this is a guy, he's got like the Monstars from Space Jam, like his confidence and powers have just been sapped. Tavares too, like, oh, what do I gotta do to get a goal? And they put him on the first line and everything, and it actually doesn't go so badly, except for they don't get a goal. So I think the game really was that simple, but while I'm shooting this video, I'm waiting for some updates from Leafs PR. We'll see if there are any call-ups. Is Nick Robertson gonna get into the lineup, for example? Joey Anderson, something like that. So, let's talk about the team, and then we'll talk about David Ayres. From producer Drew from Sportsnet, is Joe Thornton better than John Tavares? You know what, Drew? I'm sitting here trying to think of an insult that I could say about your Colorado Avalanche, and it's so difficult because they're such a good team, so I will merely say that I hope the bottom of your jeans gets a little bit damp, and then it's like that for a few hours and it's really annoying. Not a question, but I just want to say hi, and I really like your content and look forward to it. That's a really nice thing that you said. Have you been on the internet before? You're not doing it right. But thank you. In retrospect, would we rather have played against Markstrom? Yeah, man, I don't understand it. Sometimes there's just a goalie or a player that has your number. For the Leafs, it's 2 goalies who, like, aren't even their team's starter. There's Dave Rittich and Alexander Georgiev. Like, those guys just stone the Leafs almost every time. And that was a 34 save gem from Big Saved David. Other than the one softy, what did you think of Hutch? I thought he played pretty well. Yeah. He's played in 2 games, and they both went decently well. Probably 1 softy in both, but overall gave his team a chance to win and was not the reason his team lost. That is a difficult conversation for your backup. right? And last year, that was the problem. You cannot be having your backup giving up softies all the time. Not to mention on the second half of a back-to-back, it was asinine what they did with Hutchinson last season. This year, the guy's the third goalie. Like, I understand not liking it, but complaining about it? What is the team supposed to do? Sign an awesome third goalie like everybody else? That's not how it works. I said it before, I'll say it again. The best third goalie is a prospect who is waivers exempt and you can call up and down. But in terms of signing a veteran like, oh, I don't know, Aaron Dell and parking him there and waiting for an opportunity, they get claimed on waivers all the time. It happens all the time. Jack Campbell, for example, is the best backup goalie the Leafs have had since Curtis McElhinney, who they claimed on waivers, and Columbus probably wasn't happy about it. And Columbus hasn't had that problem for a while because guess what? They call up their goalie prospects. This isn't me dumping on the Leafs for that, by the way. They've drafted a lot of goalies recently. They're working their way up. Freddie, it doesn't sound like it's too serious. It sounds like they're sitting him in hopes that it doesn't become serious, and Jack Campbell should be back soon. So even if Freddie goes down, Jack will be back. I'm not worried. Who plays you in the David Ayers movie? Joe Pesci. All right, screw you! More like Channing Tatum with his shirt off, am I right? He's got brown hair, yeah. God, I need a haircut, and I'm gonna get one tomorrow. Make fun of Oshawa some more, Toronto! I'm sorry. Yeah, so apparently there's gonna be a David Ayers movie, and that's so... I mean, we knew it when we saw it. We knew it in the moment we were watching a Disney movie. We just didn't know it was gonna get made into an actual Disney movie. In terms of who's gonna play me, I hope I'm not in it. I highly doubt I'd be in it on account of I didn't do anything other than make a video after, like a bunch of other people. I don't think they would go with someone my age. I think if they were to have a YouTuber screaming about that game, they would have like one of the kids from Stranger Things or something like that. The most likely answer is, Steve, get over yourself. You're not gonna be in a friggin' Disney movie. So I don't know if you've seen it yet, but up on the Sportsnet YouTube channel, there's at least one video of me with David Ayers. There might be a second one going up today, but the one that went up yesterday is me versus David Ayers on Jeff Merrick's backyard rink, 10-shot shootout for revenge. Once again, you'll have to check that out in the Sportsnet YouTube channel. I'm not going to spoil how it went, but it was a lot of fun. And I just got to say, David Ayers is such a great guy and such a great sport. And after last year, screaming repeatedly that he was a 42-year-old Zamboni driver who works for the team, I'm very grateful for what a good sport he is throughout all this. It's not even just that he was a good sport and he agreed to do this feature. Like, I reached out to his wife, Sarah, when we were trying to raise money for Easter Seals Ontario, and all they had to do was throw their name behind it, and they did. And because of the phenomenon that is David Ayers, they raised like $3,000 for kids with physical disabilities. That's life-changing for someone. Great guy, he deserves everything he's gotten, and that includes a actual Disney movie. It's wild. Okay, final thoughts, because I haven't gotten any more Leafs news, and I want to wrap this video up. If the Leafs try the load-up first line one more time, I won't be too mad about it. I'm not a big fan of it overall, though. In fact, I like what they went with in the third a bit more. I think it was Kerfoot with Matthews and Marner, and then Barabanov, which still doesn't really make sense on the second line, but at least with Tavares and Nylander. Here's what I don't get. Kerfoot has actually been doing really well recently, and I get that's probably why you put him with Matthews and Marner, but Matthews and Marner have been working perfectly fine together, with or without Joe Thornton up there, so I would plug and play the top line. Give it to someone who you know is going to work hard and try to create chances. A Travis Boyd, a Nick Petan, I would gladly throw up there with those two. Kerfoot, Tavares, Nylander, I would completely leave alone. The bottom six, I don't really have a problem with. In terms of calling anybody up, it sounds like Thornton and Hyman are actually going to be back pretty soon, unless there's some news I don't know about. And Nick Robertson starting the AHL has actually been pretty good. Let's let him build into a rhythm. We're talking about development here with him, right? It's not just about helping the team right away, which I think he can do. But let's develop him into an even more dangerous player. Get him in some actual hockey games first. So, that is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. Brand new podcast is up. And my shootout with David Ayers on the Sportsnet YouTube channel. Check it out.